हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू माय लाइव टीचिंग लर्निंग सेशन ऑफ इंडियन इकोनॉमी बीईसीई 145। टुडेज टॉपिक इज ह्यूमन कैपिटल फॉर्मेशन, एजुकेशन सेक्टर एंड हेल्थ सेक्टर, व्हिच इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट। एजुकेशन एंड हेल्थ इज इंक्लूडेड इन ह्यूमन कैपिटल फॉर्मेशन। There are three types of resources which are necessary for the economy development. One is natural resource, second is physical capital formation, and third is human capital formation. Human capital formation can be achieved or can be increased with the help of education sector and health sector. What are the sources of human capital formation? There are five sources of human capital formation. One is education, second is health, third is on the job training, fourth is migration, and fifth is information. These all resources make human capital formation. Now, first is investment in education. Government should more money invest in education, because if country people are educated, then they can give more contribution in the production of goods and services. People spend money on education of their children to increase their skill. Expenditure on investment is not called only expenditure, it's an investment. Because if you spend more money on education, it means that will give you more income in future. That's why education expenditure is not considered as an expenditure, it's an investment. It gives benefit to the student or country people. Second source of human capital formation is health. A healthy person performs better than sick person. A sound body has sound mind, so that body should be, we should keep body our fit. That's why health is also the main source of human capital formation. Hence, investment in health is also required for making good human capital formation. Third is migration. People migrate from one place to another to get better job opportunities. If migration is possible, if one person can move from another place for getting more and good opportunities, then it will also help in human capital formation. Next is information. Better information and information technology also play very important role in human capital formation. People use information from various sources like internet, magazines to get better job opportunities. So information also play very important role. Next is on the job training. On the job training means when people get training while doing their jobs, or we can say that if companies train their employees so that they perform better in jobs. So these five sources are included in human capital formation. And these are very important sources, because without any one of this resource, we can't make good capital formation or human capital formation. So these are the five sources of human capital formation. One is investment in education, second is health, third is migration, fourth is information, and fifth is on the job training. Now we will explain in detail what is education and education help to increase the human capital formation, and what the role of health sector perform in our economy to get or to achieve this human capital formation. Now, first of all, we have to understand what is human capital. Human capital refers to the stock of skills and knowledge gained by a worker through education and experience to perform labor so as to produce economic value. Human beings are also called a capital, and investment on education and expenditure on education and expenditure on health, it's not only an expenditure, it's an investment, because it will increase the capability of the country people so that they can give more contribution in GDP. And if our country's GDP increases, then our economy's income will also increase. When income will increase, per capita income will also increase. And due to increase in per capita income, standard of living of the country people will also increase. And it will help in achieving the economic development and economic growth at a very faster rate. So human capital is very necessary for the development of the country. Japanese economy is well developed economy because they have good human beings, and human capital formation is too much in that economy. They don't have natural resources, but they have human capital formation. So human capital formation also play very important role in the achievement of country's growth and development. And human capital is the stock of skill and knowledgeful person gained by a worker through education and experience to perform labor so as to produce economic value or to produce more goods and services. So this is the definition of human capital. Next is human capital formation in India. According to Alfred Marshall, the wisdom of expending public and private funds on education is not to be measured by its direct fruit alone. It will be profitable as a mere investment to give the masses of people much greater opportunities than they can generally avail themselves of. For by this means, many who would have died unknown are enabled to get the start needed for bringing out their latent abilities. According to Alfred Marshall said that expenditure on education is very profitable, and it's not give direct benefit to that person who is educated. It give benefit to whole the society, because if one person is educated, then he can educate to other persons also. If a woman is educated, it means their children will also be educated, and whole family she can manage very efficiently. If she will be educated, then she will be definitely skilled or knowledgeful, and each and every activity she can manage in a very good manner. So if a person is educated, it can't be measured by only direct fruit alone. It will be profitable for whole the society, for whole the economy, for whole the nation. It gives benefit to the masses of people and provide much greater opportunities, not only that person only. It gives opportunities to all, not by only that person who is educated. For by this means, many who would have died unknown are unable to get the start needed for bringing out their latent abilities. We can achieve our abilities, we can increase our abilities or capabilities with the help of education. So human capital formation in India is very useful and very important concept, because human beings in India is in a large quantity. Here human beings are abundant because India is second most largest populated country in the world. That's why human beings are available in our country in a very larger quantity, but we must have to increase their ability, their skills, their capabilities, so that they can give more contribution in the production of goods and services. But in India, here the quality of the people are not very good. Quantity of people is too much, but quality of the country people is not very good and not giving more contribution in GDP due to lack of educational facilities and lack of medical facilities or lack of perfect health. Or we can say that if in our country education and health facilities are in lack or in a very limited regions, then we can't achieve higher growth rate of the country. Government should spend more money on education and health also, because a good health, a healthy person or good health person can give more contribution in our country's growth and development. So human capital formation is very important for all the economies, for all the nations. Human capital is related with, directly related with economic growth. If human capital is, human capital formation is very good in our country, then economic growth definitely will be higher. Enhanced productivity of human capital contributes substantially not only towards increased labor productivity, but also stimulates economic growth. So human capital formation and economic growth are positively related with each other. Higher human capital formation leads to higher economic growth, and lower human capital formation leads to lower economic growth. And how we can increase human capital? We can increase human capital by investing more money on education and education and health or medical facilities, so that we can increase the humans' productivity or their contribution in GDP. So human capital and economic growth both are interrelated with each other, and both are positively or directly related with each other. Next is, what is the difference between human capital and development or human development? These two concepts are different from each other. One is human capital and other concept is human development. By the name of these words, we think that both are similar, both are same or synonyms, but they have some differences. Human capital is the skill and knowledge which provides economic value. And human development is the process of improving life of people without considering economic value. Human capital is an economic concept, and human development, if we are talking about human development, so this concept is social concept, because we all need development. All country people need development. That's why whole society, when whole society wants development, then this concept is called social concept. Human capital, how we can achieve or we can increase human capital formation? If investment in health and education do not increase economic value, it is not human capital. If investment in health and education increase the economic value of the human beings, then it will be called human capital. If investment in health and education do not increase economic value, still it is human development. It means human capital will increase when economic value of country people increase. But human development will increase if investment in health and education will not increase the economic value of the country people, but still it will be called human development. It means human capital is related with only economic value, but human development is not related with economic value of the country people. It's the process of improving life of the people. Increase in human capital leads to human development. An increase in human development may not generate human capital. It means human capital. If human capital increase, definitely human development will also increase. But if human development increase, it will not generate human capital. Human capital is a narrow concept because it's only an economic concept, and it mainly focuses on economic value of the country people. But human development is a very broader concept. It focuses on overall development of the country people, and it is based on overall increase in standard of living of the country people, not only specific person skill and knowledge and increase in their economic value, which is considered in economic human capital. So human development is a very broader concept in which human capital is also included, so that we can say that human capital and human development both are different concepts. Sometimes they are interrelated, but they have some differences also. So human capital is an economic concept, and human development is a social concept. Human capital gives more focus on economic value of the country people, but human development not give more value of economic value of country people. It's give more focuses on the improvement of all country people status and their standard of living. So this is the basic difference. Next is the role of education in our country, in our society. Education is the first component of, first source of human capital. Why education and health is included in human capital formation? First is education. Education is the backbone of society and is the basis for growth, progress, and development of any country, either it may be developed or developing or underdeveloped. Education plays a very important role for the development of whole the country. Government since independence has made concerted efforts to spread literacy among the people, to make them self-reliant and give them opportunity to learn. Therefore, number of initiatives and steps have been taken by the government to improve the education sector and to enhance the quality of education, and can be regarded as some of the achievements in the field of education. Government has taken some effective steps and measures to encourage education among the children, like Navodaya Vidyalaya has been established in each district, and government has compulsory the education from 0 to 14 years children education for all or universalization of education is the main campaign, which is widespread, which is playing very important role in whole the world, and it's a basis of growth. And government is also spending more money on education, but still in India, the expenditure on education is less. If we compare India's expenditure on education by the government with the if we compare with the other developed nations or any other developing nations, we found that India's expenditure on education is still very less as compared to other nations. But government should spend more money on education and health so that human capital formation can be made. Government after independence, because before independence in our country, illiteracy rate was very higher. Near about 80% country people were illiterate. Only 20% people were literate at that time. But at present, near about 60% people are literate and 40% people are still illiterate. There is a difference between literacy and education. Literacy rate means if you have a knowledge of read and write, then you are called literate. But if you are educated, it means if you have a degree of bachelor degree, post-graduation degree, or if you have passed your 10 plus 2 or senior secondary examination, then you will be called educated. If you know about only how to read and how to write, if you can do your signature and you can read the book, that is called only literacy rate. Literacy. If a person is literate, only he can, he has the ability of write and read only. But if he is educated, it means he has gotten the education of senior secondary examination, he has passed, and graduation, post-graduation, and other degrees also. Then a person will be called educated. So government should take some steps, and government has taken some effective steps also to encourage education among the children. Government increases the number of schools. In India, Indian economy is a mixed economy. Here, public sector and private sector both are coexist in it. That's why in India, here public schools and private schools are in India is working for giving educational facilities to the children. So education is very necessary for all the countries' growth and development. Next is, what is current education system? The current education system of the India is generally referred to as the 10 plus 2 plus 3 pattern. If a person has passed 10th class examination or senior secondary examination, which is called 10 plus 2, and if he is graduated also, so we can say that 10 plus 2 plus 3, this pattern is called the educational structure of India. The first 10 years provide undifferentiated general education for all students, in which we read English, maths, science, social study, and Hindi. And the plus two stage, also known as the higher secondary or senior secondary education, which provides for differentiation into academic and vocational streams like art stream, commerce stream, and science stream, and marks the end of school education. In plus three stage, which involves college education, the student goes for higher studies in his or her chosen field of subject. But in India, dropout rate is higher. Here's children and students get admission in 10 plus 2 or 10 plus 2 plus 3, but some students drop out in between of their educational time period. In primary education, which is 1st to 5th, the rate of dropout is 31.47%. And middle education, which is known as 1st to 8th class, in this education system, the dropout rate is 52.32%. And in secondary education, which is called 1 to 10, that is the dropout rate is 62.69%. It means the dropout rate is increasing as well as we move from primary education to middle education and middle education to secondary education and secondary education to higher secondary or higher secondary to 10 plus 2 plus 3 or college education. It means students get admission in 10 plus 2, 10 plus 2 plus 3, but in between their education, they drop out from their stream, and for any family problems and any other problems, that's why in India, education, here educated people numbering is less as compared to developed nations. That's why we can say that in India, 40% people are still illiterate, only 60% people are educated or literate. So this is the current education system. Next is facts of education in India. India spends only 3.3% of its GDP on education, which is very less amount, as compared to an average 5.8% in developed countries. So in India, expenditure on education is very less. And in developed nations, education expenditure on education is in large quantity. GOI means Government of India had made a commitment to spend 6% of GDP on education in 1968. However, the highest spend made so far is only 4% of GDP. Because government made some targets in 5-year plannings after independence, but not achieved all the set targets fully. We achieved only partially the set targets, not fully. That's why we can say that our economic goals or our targets of the economic planning are partially successful, not fully successful. So India should spend more money on education for the development of the country. Then we can achieve our higher growth rate of the country, and we can make our economy as a developed country, but still India is a developing country. Of the 32 million children that began school in 2004, less than half will complete the compulsory 8 years of education. The common reason given by 3 out of 4 dropouts for leaving school are high cost of private education. In India, private schools are taking very large fees or very huge amount of education from the children. Education sector is not called at present, it's a noble sector or it's a very kind sector which is giving education for all, for making society to get highly educated. Here all types of sector, either it may be health sector or it may be education sector, both are commercialized, both are working for making more profits, and to gain more profits, they are making at present more profit at the cost of children's education. They are dropout, they are leaving schools because their family's income is not very higher, and the numbering of government schools are very less in different states, in regions. In some states, government schools are very less and private schools are not opened there, because private schools mainly opened at that place where infrastructure is good and where the area is urban area and where the country people can afford their fees and they can pay the cost of the education. But in India, we know that here poverty level of the country people are very higher. Here masses of people are poor, which are living below poverty line. They are called BPL. They can't satisfy their basic needs also, like food, clothes, shelter, education, health, sanitation. Then how they can afford educational fees or school fees? And sometimes they need to work to support their families. That's why they have to drop out from their schooling education and no interest in studies. Third, the main motive, the main fact is the lack of interest of the student in getting education. Because in India, education sector, they think that in education, if we educated, then here unemployment is exist in a large number. Massive of people are unemployed. Either they are highly educated but not getting job opportunities. If they are highly educated but not getting job opportunities, then what is the value of education? What is the role of education in their living standard and increasing the growth of the country? So they don't have interest in study because they think that if highly educated people are unemployed, so what is the main goal of education? Why they will get education? So these are the facts of education in India. In India, here the people are drop out in the age of 8 years of education. The common reason is three. One is high cost of private education. It can be found everywhere. Educational expenditures or educational cost is increasing day by day. Private schools are taking too much fees from the students. Either their parents can afford or not, but they are taking more fees. That's why some students drop out for leaving school. Second is need to work to support their family because they are living below poverty line and they want to support their family. That's why in a very little age or smaller age, they start working for earning or surviving their families. And third is no interest in study. So this is the fact of education in India. Next is government expenditure on education. How much our government is spending money on education? In 2013 or 14 year, the expenditure of the government on GDP is 3.1%. Next is, as percentage to total expenditure, government budget expenditure as percentage of budget is 1.47. In 2014-15, expenditure as percent to GDP is 2.8. And expenditure as percent of budget is only 1.29. In 2015-16, it remains same. Expenditure as percent to GDP is 2.8. And the expenditure as percent of budget is 1.43. It increased from 1.29 to 1.43. In 2017-18, expenditure as percent to GDP is 2.9 and expenditure as percent of budget is 1.62. But still, it is very less. It means the expenditure on education, either it will be calculated as the percentage to GDP or expenditure as percentage of budget, it is very lower. Expenditure as percent to GDP is 3% in 2018-19, and as a percentage of budget, it is only 1.43. It means in India, government is spending very less amount on education. That's why we have not still achieved fully literacy rate, or here 100% people are not literate and not highly educated. In India, still 40% people are still illiterate. Due to less expenditure on education by the government. Next is, second, the main source of human capital formation is health. Health play very important role in human capital formation. First, the main source of human capital formation is education, and other is health. Because without sound health, we can't have sound mind. So, what are the indicators of health? Indicators, also termed as index or variable, is only an indication of a given situation or a reflection of that situation. Health indicator is a variable, susceptible to direct measurement, that reflects the state of health of persons in a community. Indicators help to measure the extent to which the objectives and targets of a program are being attained. Numerical indication of the health of a given population derived from a specified composite formula. So, indicator of health is a term which can be used as a health index, or as a variable which indicates the given situation or reflection of that situation. So, human capital formation, in the human capital formation, the second main source which gives more contribution in increasing the level of human beings is health. If government spend more money on health facilities or on medical facilities, then country people can achieve good health and can protect themselves from diseases and give more contribution in the production of goods and services, so that our economy can achieve higher growth rate. Health sector. National health policy government has made in 2002. What are the main objectives of National Health Policy 2002? The main objectives of this policy is, number one is achieving an acceptable standard of good health of Indian population. Second main objective is decentralization or decentralizing public health system by upgrading infrastructure in existing institutions. And the third main goal of National Health Policy of 2002 is ensuring a more equitable access to health services across the social and geographical expanse of India. It means this health policy mainly focuses on achieving the standard of good health of Indian population. But in India, Here, the quantity of the country people are in large number, but the quality of the country people are very poor. Because here, malnutrition exists and anemia and other diseases, lack of good health or medical facilities are not also available in each and every district, each and every state of the Indian economy. And hospitals are, as we know that Indian economy is a mixed economy, so that here private hospitals and government hospitals both are coexist in it. But the numbering of private hospitals are in huge numbers and the government hospitals numbers are very less. And we know that in India, here larger population is still living below poverty line or poor. They can't afford private hospitals expenditure, and the main motive of private hospitals are to earn maximum profit at the cost of human life. That's why here the health facilities or medical facilities are not available in a large quantity, so that country people are not in a sound body. They don't have sound body and they are not in a good health position. So government should decentralize all the public health system by upgrading infrastructure, and government should increase the numbering of hospitals in each and every state so that all country people can take medical facilities according to their need and at a very less cost of medical expenses, ensuring a more equitable access to health services across the social and geographical expense of India. So these are the main objectives or goals of the National Health Policy of 2002. Next is National Health Policy of 2017. This is the latest policy which is going on. Draft of National Health Policy 2015 to achieve the Millennium Development Goals. This MDG is Millennium Development Goals of the United Nations, reviewed the progress made so far and suggested two strategies of health for all. This concept implying health as an integral part of development and universal health coverage. Same as when education is necessary for all the country people, same as health facilities are also very necessary for whole the society, for whole the country people. So universalization of education is important, same as universalization of health facilities are also very important, and it play very important role in human capital formation. Draft NHP, it means National Health Policy, formulated and placed in public domain in December 2014. National Health Policy of 2017, the main goal of this, the socio-economic and epidemiological changes since last National Health Policy of 2002 call for the formulation of a new policy to address the current and emerging challenges. The main challenge of the health policy is that medical facilities are not widespread and not equitably accessible for all the country people. So this is the main challenge for our government. Government should provide educational facilities and medical facilities in each and every state, and it should be accessible for all the country people so that they can take advantages of this and they can increase the human capital formation. So So these are the main goals of National Health Policy of 2017. Next is public health spending. How much government is spending money on health sector? India's public expenditure on health as a share of total health spending is half of the world's average. A look at some expenditure indicators of select countries below gives an idea of why the government needs to urgently step up investment in healthcare. Key health financing indicators 2014. Total health expenditure as a share of GDP in a percentage, India has only 4.7%. And Brazil is spending the share of GDP on its health sector is 8.3%. Russia is spending 7.1%. US is spending 17.1% on health sector. And China is spending 5.5%. China is also a developing country, but China still spending a larger amount as compared to India on health sector. And South Africa is spending 8.8% on health sector. Public expenditure on health as a share of GDP, first was the total health expenditure. Next is public sector expenditure on health as a share of GDP percentage. In India, this percentage is only 1.4. In Brazil, this percentage is 3.8. Russia, 3.7. In US, 8.3. In China, 3.1. And in South Africa, this percentage is 4.2. In all the different countries, the percentage public expenditure on health as a share of GDP is higher than India's expenditure. India's expenditure on health sector is very lower. Public expenditure on health as a share of total health expenditure percentage is 30% in India only, but in Brazil 46%, in Russia 52.2%, in US 48.3%, in China 44.2%, and in South Africa it's a 48.2%. Private expenditure on health as a share of total health expenditure percentage in India is 70%. It means in India, private expenditure on health sector is higher, but the public expenditure on health sector is lower. It means government is spending less amount on health sector, but private hospitals, private expenditure on health is increasing. And the discrimination or this difference is not giving more contribution in health sector. Private expenditure is increasing because they want to earn maximum profit. And their expenditure on health sector and on education sector is only for making profits, not for providing more facilities to the patients or country people. And in Brazil, private expenditure is 54%, Russia 47.8%, in US 51.7%, in China 44.2%. It means in China, government expenditure is higher, but the private expenditure on health is lower. But in India, the situation is totally different from these countries. In India, private expenditure on a health sector is higher and the public expenditure on health sector is lower. It means in India, there are only profit earning motive and all these sectors are commercialized. Either it may be education sector or it may be health sector. So with the help of this table, we know that we can know that that India's expenditure on health sector is still very lower if we compare with rest of the world and different nations of the world. Next is government expenditure on health in 2012. Here the advanced economies in US 47% government is spending money. In Spain, 71.7%. In UK, 84% money is spending on health sector. In France, 77.4%. In Germany, 76.7%. In Italy, 77.3%. And in Japan, 82.1%. The larger amount expenditure on health is spending by two countries, Japan and UK. But in India, the expenditure on health sector is only 30%. And in Brazil, 47.5%. In Russian Federation, 51.1%. And in China, 56%. So with the help of this figure, we can understand that in India, expenditure on health by government is very less in India. And the other countries, developed nations and emerging economies, except India, they are spending a lot of amount on health sector. That's why the health sector or country people, their life expectancy of their country people are higher than Indian life expectancy. In India, life expectancy is only 65 years. But in different developed nations, life expectancy or the average age which people think to live is near about 85-year age or 90-year age. This is the basic difference between the developed and developing nation. Next is role of human capital. What is the role of human capital? What role human capital play in our country? As you know that human capital formation has five sources, which is education, health, on-the-job training, migration, and information, in which two things mainly play very important role. One is education and other is medical facilities or health sector. So human capital play very important role in each and every country. If we want to achieve higher growth rate of the country, then we must increase human capital formation. It give contribution in country's development. If the human capital is developed, then country will also be developed. Second is, if we want to improve the quality of the life of the country people, then human capital formation should be increased. Third is, it create positive attributes. It means it provide positive attributes for the country. If country people have positive attributes regarding their life and their living standard, then human capital formation give very important role. Next is eradication of social backwardness. If we want to eradicate, we want to reduce, we want to eliminate social backwardness, then we must increase human capital formation. So this is the important role of human capital formation. Next is, what problems we have to face while we achieve this goal, human capital formation. In India, there are lots of problems exist, which are the main hindrance or obstacle in achievement of the human capital formation. The main problem is rapidly growing population. As you know that India is second largest most populated country in the world. In India, population growth rate is near about 1.7%. But in developed nations, population is growing only by the rate of 0.1% or 0.2% or less than 1% rate. In India, population is growing at a very faster rate, and at present, India's population is near about 140 crore, which is very higher. If population is growing with the rate of this 1.7% or at a very faster rate, then definitely human capital formation we can't achieve fully. Because if government is increasing number of schools and if government is providing more medical facilities, but simultaneously population also increasing, then definitely there will be a lack of medical facilities and there will be a lack of educational facilities by increasing rapidly growing population. Second thing is lack of awareness. In India, there is a lack of awareness. There is not people fully aware in education or health sector. Due to lack of awareness, human capital formation is still not fully achieved by the Indian economy. Third is unequal distribution of wealth. In India, there is a widespread inequality exists. What is the meaning of inequality? Inequality means when the society is divided into two categories, one is haves and other is haves not, or one is rich and other is poor. In India, where there is a lot of difference between rich and poor, there is a class struggle between rich and poor. Rich becomes more richer and poor becomes more poorer. That's why the unequal distribution of wealth is also responsible for the less achievement in human capital formation. Next is investment in buildings and equipments. In India, here people are investing their money in buildings and equipments, but not investing their money on education and health. So if education and health infrastructure is not good, and if government is not spending much amount on education or required amount which is necessary for the development of our country, if government is not spending much amount on education and health facilities, and government is investing only in increasing the corporate sector's businesses, or government is investing their money in buildings and equipments, then human capital formation can't be made. Next is inappropriate education. In India, here the education system is inappropriate. Here we have given only subjective knowledge, not professional or technical knowledge. But at present, India has started skill enhancement courses, and here India is improving their education system by providing vocational education and professional education, because subjective knowledge can't give you job opportunities. You are not able to get job only by studying subjects only. You must have technical knowledge, advanced knowledge, professional knowledge, and must increase skill enhancement courses also, so that country people can increase their standard of living and they can achieve higher human development rate. Ill health and ill nutritional facilities. In India, here people are suffering from ill health and ill nutritional or malnutritional situations. That's why they are not healthy and giving less contribution in GDP. No proper training for employees. In India, there is no proper training facilities for all the employees of the country. That's why this is the main problem of achieving the rate of human capital formation. Next is agriculture is the main occupation, and agriculture is the predominant sector in India. Here, more than 50% of the country people are still dependent on agriculture sector. And here no manpower planning is also the responsible problem or factor of human capital formation. So these are the problems of human capital formation. Next is conclusion. Now in this topic, human capital formation, in which you have studied about the sources of human capital formation, how human capital formation can increase, and how it gives contribution in the growth rate of the country, is development. So investment in human capital is also required to raise the general living standard of the people. In developing countries, this is possible when education and training make full and rational utilization of surplus manpower by providing larger and better job opportunities in both rural and areas. There is more return risk in income and improvement in living standard of the population due to capital formation. So human capital formation play very important role, and the expenditure on education and expenditure on health is not called only expenditure, it's a investment. If government invests more money on education and health, then we can achieve higher rate of human capital formation, and definitely it will provide more and better living standard of the country people. Thank you so much.